Heavenly Father, we come before you in Jesus' name, and I thank you and praise you for this day. Thank you for this wonderful nation in which we live. Thank you, Lord, for salvation. How can we ever thank you for redeeming us from the powers of darkness and sin, for freeing us from the sense of guilt and fear and frustration, and giving us the ability to live our life in peace and in the prosperity that only you can bring. I thank you for it. I praise you. I praise you for this place that you created and brought into existence by your Spirit. I thank you, Lord, for Sister Snyder, who had the vision for this place, for Sister Scholl, that came and stood in the gap. And thank you for the dedicated people who have served in the various offices and responsibilities of this place over the years. Thank you, Jesus, for the honor of serving you. And we ask that you would bless and that you'd pour out your anointing this day, and that every person that comes will be ministered to and strengthened by your Spirit. Bless our ministry unto you now in praise, and we receive this in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen.
Jesus.
We bless you, Lord.
Glory
Jesus.
To you.
Thank you.
Oh, thank you, Jesus. You're worthy, Lord.
Glory.
We praise you, Jesus. Jesus.
Praise.
Thank you, Lord.
My love on you. church. Lift your voices to him today. Lift your voices right now in praise and glory and honor to him, Lord Jesus. Oh, Jesus, you are worthy, Lord. Oh, Lord, you are so worthy, Lord Jesus. We praise you, Lord. We're pouring it out to you right now, Lord Jesus. Pour it out. Pour it out. Pour it out, Lord Jesus. Jesus, Jesus.
Folks that are listening to us at home, thank you for being part of our church family or our internet family. Obviously, you don't have to do that. You've got a clicker on your dial. And I think about it. I think about the really wonderful ministries that are on the Christian stations and on television, and the fact that you would care to listen to presentation from this humble servant. It is a great honor to me, and I thank you for that. And pray with me that what is brought forth today will be a blessing, that the Holy Spirit's anointing will always be upon what we present, that it'll be the truth. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word and for your truth, for your anointing. And Jesus, help us today. Help us today to be able to present the heart of the Holy Spirit. And we receive that ability in your name. Amen. I want to speak to you today about authority and the breakdown of authority in our country and the tragedy that is creating. I have the privilege of talking to a state policeman every once in a while, and we were coming through Illinois. This has been a few years ago, and I was going too fast and got pulled over, and he said, "Put your hands on the steering wheel. Put your hands on the steering wheel." And I'm thinking, why should I do that? But the policeman that is coming up from the back, who doesn't have any idea what's in that car, is going to see that your hands are there and you are not armed in any way to do him harm. And so I did it. I did it. And personally, even as a child, I mean, I did things that my dad gave me spankings for. And they were more like whippings. I mean, he got a stick off a tree and he laced my hiney. And things like lying, and mostly that's what it was for lying. And but the one thing that I came to respect the authority that was in my dad. If he asked me to do something, I tried to do it. I was taught to respect authority. One of my favorite pictures is the one that appeared on the Saturday Evening Post years ago, of the policeman sitting on a bar stool with the little boy right there beside him. You know, and you probably have seen that picture. And children were taught to respect the police. They were taught to respect the fire people, firemen. They were taught to respect anybody that was in a position of authority. In fact, the word to me was, when I went to school, said, if you get a spanking in school, you will have another one waiting you when you get home. No questions asked. No questions asked. Was the teacher right? Was the principal right? You violated authority. You were going to dance to the tune. Simple. Now, was authority always right? No. But even when Dale was little and in school here, on our report cards, we had these ratings along with the grades. We had these ratings like, you know, good, bad, ugly. And there was one on there called N, and it was for needs improvement. And I told Dale, I said, you come home with an N, and we call them naughty N's. You come home with an N, and you're getting it. Well, he's in Mrs. Malone's class. And Mrs. Malone found out about that and stopped giving him naughty N's. But the whole idea was, you know, Dad, the teacher, I said, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear it. Teacher's in control. Teacher's in authority. Teacher's right. Now, is the teacher always right? No. I remember the time distinctly that John Nichols was in school, and he came up, and I thought for a fact he did something. And boy, I let into him, and he came up to me and said, Pastor Moore, he said, I really didn't do that. And come to find out, he really didn't do that. And, you know, the pride within me did not want to admit that I had made a major blunder, but the Holy Spirit within me outweighed my pride. Pride goeth before a fall. And I said, John, I am so sorry. I was so wrong. I accused Dale one time of doing something that was wrong. I even spanked him for it. And he didn't do it. Now, I don't want to sound like I was just always beating on my child. You know, he might have had two or three his whole life. But anyway, this time, I did, and I was wrong, and I found out he was innocent. So I'm thinking, what do I do? What do I do? And so I remember I called him down. I was in the little sun porch there in my house. I called him down. I said, Dale, I was wrong. And I am so sorry. And you have my permission to go get the paddle and come down and paddle me. And he looked at me and he said, Dad, I would never do that. My son never one time lifted a hand against me. He didn't always agree with me. Sometimes he fussed with me. But he has always respected authority. I had a friend that I played fast pitch softball with right out of college. We had a really good church team. We were in Springfield, Missouri. They had a big league. They had guys that threw faster than I ever saw anybody throw a baseball. And it was right before I was to go into service. And his name was Clem. And Clem and I were playing catch. He was a pitcher, and I was just playing catch with him. And he said, well, now I know you're getting ready to go into service. And he'd been in the Navy. And Clem said to me, let me tell you something. He said, get this in your mind. The Army makes the rules. If you will go in and obey and flow under the rules, you'll be promoted. But if you go in and resist the rules and rebel, you will be demoted. I remember the day that Specialist 5th Class Doister got fed up with the first sergeant, and he decided to take a shot at him with an M16. Doister was college graduate, chemistry major, and he was smart enough that after he did that, the officer from the motor pole got him in the car, took him down to Quinyon, where there was a psychologist, and worked all that out to where, instead of going to Long Bend Jail, Doister wound up just getting broken down to PFC. But bad idea to shoot at your supervising officer. And so I wanted to talk with you about what's going on in our culture and in our society today. It's really sad that we have such disrespect for people who are giving their lives to stand between us and absolute anarchy. I realize that there are officers in every capacity. There are people who are not right with the Lord. They don't act in accordance with respect to humans the way that they should. But that's a small, small minority of people. People that put on those uniforms in the morning and they go out, they know that, I mean, I don't think they dwell on that, but they have to at least think about it. Today, somebody could try to shoot me. You know, most of you have never had that experience, but I remember I was riding in a Jeep going into Bambi Tuit, and I'm just thinking, I'm looking around and thinking, there's people out there that's, they would love to shoot me. In fact, they're looking for a way to be able to do that. Now, it was like, kind of like, I don't know, I just never had this concept. There's somebody out there trying to kill me. And to know that, and then still be willing to, if necessary, run into a raging inferno with the potential that the walls of that building could collapse on you. You'll never see your wife again, never see your children again, and still do that is something that needs to be respected by our civilization. Because if we don't respect authority, we will become anarchy. And if we become anarchy, we will lose our freedoms. When God created Israel, He created a free people. They were free underneath His law. And His law was given to cause them to live and not die. Now, some of that was really hard. You go to Deuteronomy chapter 20 and begin to read there. Like, if so-and-so does this, take him outside the city gate, stone him to death. You say, well, that sounds like what the Muslims are doing over there in the Middle East now. But in some respect, that law of God was put there so there would be respect for authority, there would be order and stability, and God is just. Here's the deal. God's laws are just. God's laws are just. And the only nation other than Israel itself that ever had its laws based on God's laws was the United States of America. England, to some extent, because it developed what was called common law, and common law rested upon biblical law and decisions made by judges after having looked at God's word and God's law. As we have abandoned God's truth and God's word and God's law, we begin to get injustice. In the name of justice, we are now getting injustice. I was thinking about this coming home. The first form of government that we had after and during the Revolution and afterwards was something called the Articles of Confederation. And the states were so concerned that they would be leaving one dictatorial power, King George III, and move under another dictatorial king here. And so they wanted to protect the sovereignty of the state. You have to remember, each state was an independent nation. It was the nation of Rhode Island, the state of Rhode Island, the state of Maryland, the state of New Jersey. These were independent states that were coming together to form a loose government over the top to do for them what they could not do by themselves. Well, they didn't have any provision there for calling up really an army or a militia to help in time of need. For instance, down in North Carolina, the governor called up the National Guard. Well, at that time, there was no National Guard as such. There were just local militias that could be called into existence. In fact, the people who gave us our country didn't want standing armies. They were afraid of them. That's why they wanted every individual to be armed, to be ready at an instant, to be able to be called into the local militia. So if the nation was in peril, then the governor of that state could call up the National Guard. And under the articles, the president, which they really didn't have, they had kind of a president, or the article didn't have the power to do that. It was mostly a Congress. So there was a rebellion up in Massachusetts led by a man by the name of Daniel Shea. And what had happened was during the American Revolution, many of the people who were farmers had gone to fight in the war. and you had two armies that had to be fed. You had the British Army, and you had the American Army, and both of them bought food and produce from the locals. And so the people that were not fighting in the war had begun to purchase more and more land to produce more and more food for the armies. But they bought this land by getting mortgages from banks. Well, all of a sudden, the war comes to an end. The British soldiers go home, the American soldiers come home, and now there is not that need for all of that grain. And the prices begin to fall, the law of supply and demand. And all of a sudden, the farmers could not pay their mortgages. And so Daniel Shea decided, got a group of men together and said, we're not going to allow the banks to foreclose. We're going to prevent them from taking our land. But in reality, it wasn't their land because they made an agreement with the bank to use the bank's money to purchase that land. And they were breaking down on their end of it. So the Congress calls for a militia, and basically nobody responded. And that sent like fear throughout all of the people who had been in leadership positions within our country at the time of the revolution. So we can't have this. Because you see, there's three things that were God-given rights: the right to life, the right to liberty, and the right to property. And this was an attack, a direct attack against one of those rights, property rights, because the farmers were trying to steal land that they had agreed to pay for, and they couldn't put it down. So Alexander Hamilton called for a convention to meet to discuss the problem. He had talked with Washington, and they met in Annapolis. It was called the Annapolis Convention, and they agreed that they needed another one. So they called for one to happen in Philadelphia, which became the Constitutional Convention, and they developed a whole new constitution out of that, all because of property rights. Washington becomes president, and the farmers out in western Pennsylvania grew corn, and the easiest way to transport their corn was to turn it into whiskey. And so they would turn the corn into whiskey, and then they would float it or transport it, however, and whiskey almost became a type of money, where you could tell, well, yeah, I'll buy that fur off of you for a jug of whiskey. And the federal government decided they were going to put an excise tax on it. And so the farmers out in western Pennsylvania rebelled. It was called the Whiskey Rebellion. But Washington was president. It was a stronger government. He calls out the military, and he himself personally leads them out, crushes the rebellion, and it's over. And so you had these situations that developed in the nation to where you had to have order, and most of it developed around property rights and the importance of property. When the government begins to move in and take people's property, they begin indirectly to take their liberty and to take their life. Because if I own a parcel of property, I can always sell that property, and I can then use the money from it to hire somebody to protect my life. I can get rid of that property, and I can buy food. I can hire a lawyer to protect my rights. And so, in my mind, property rights are so important. The right to be able to own. And I wondered about that, because you have, like in a socialist country, people really don't have property rights. Everything belongs to the government. And the government determines where you will work. The government will determine what kind of shirt you wear by the type they decide to make. The government takes away your freedoms in the guise of making everybody equal. And it's never worked. Won't it work, but you lose everything. You lose your freedom. And so when God called Israel into existence, he made them a free people. The only thing they had to do was live underneath the authority of his law. And that law, when followed, brought freedom in every aspect of their life. Obey my commandments, and none of these diseases of Egypt will come upon you. Obey my commandments, and the rain will come in its season. Obey my commandments, and your fruit orchards will produce. I'm leading you into a land of milk and honey. Do what I'm telling you to do. Obey my commandments, and your families will be protected. Nobody's going to take your wife. Nobody's going to take your children. Nobody's going to be able to do that. And as I study through the Word, I see three major areas of authority that is acknowledged in the Bible. First, there is the authority within the church. There is order and there is a head to it. The head of the church is Jesus, who then in turn appoints men, women into positions of responsibility within that church, and he gives them authority. You can't be responsible for something if you don't have the authority to rule over it. Which brings you to Hebrews 13:17, which says, obey them that have the rule over you, for they watch for your souls as they that must give an account, that they may do it with joy and not with grief, for that is unprofitable for you. A church that is torn with dissension, that doesn't recognize the authority that's in the pastor. See, when Jesus left, he gave gifts. Some apostles, some prophets, some pastors, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers. And every one of these offices, they are offices. And then God appoints them. It's kind of like when I was in the military. You know, anybody, just an enlisted guy was an enlisted guy. But an officer, that person was appointed by the Congress of the United States. When I decided not to go to OCS because I had signed up to go, my orders no longer came from the local post. My orders came from Washington because I was under a different authority within the military. And they told me, he said, you don't do what you signed up to do. You don't go to OCS. You're going straight to Vietnam. So I went straight to Vietnam. And it wasn't, no matter what talents or skills I had that could have been used locally, wasn't there. Well, you see, that's the same with the appointments of God's offices. Those offices were created by God. He appointed people to be in charge. And that authority that's there needs to be respected. In every church, he put elders. There are deacons. There are people to help. So you need to flow under the authority for the church to function right. In the home, Colossians says, wives, submit to your own husbands. I know that flows against the grain in our society and culture today. And that's not to say that a woman doesn't have rights and she can't be equal in the sight of God, that a woman and a man don't have the same access to God. That's not true. It has to do with authority. The husband is the head of the wife, and he is the person that is responsible for maintaining the harmony, the peace, the provision within there. The wife is his helpmeet to help him carry out his authority. She's not over him. I think that's what it means. It says any man that prays having his head covered dishonors God. And any woman that prays without her head covered dishonors her husband, dishonors God. What is that talking about? Are all women supposed to be wearing hats to church and men take, that's where the custom of taking your hat off at the door came from. What's that all about? Well, I think a man that allows his authority to be usurped by his wife is having his head covered. And there is something in between him and the Almighty God. And any woman that does not allow her head to be covered by her husband, it says she should do this because of the angels in 1 Corinthians there, But I think, I looked that up, and I think the angels, it could be God's angels, but I think it could also be demons. Because any woman that gets out from underneath the covering of Almighty God and through her husband, I think can be exposed to demonic thoughts and create dissensions and problems within the home. There's a flow to it. And when the husband and the wife are together, working together, then the children come under that authority. They obey. Husband protects his wife from the children. Many times, wives rebel against their husband. Then the children rise up against the wife, and the husband doesn't do anything to stop it. Why? Because he's resentful to the fact that she's not flowing under his authority. And so he lets the children abuse her. When they ought to be slapped down for that. What are you doing talking to your mother that way? You're wrong. See? There's authority within the family. And then there's civil authority. Romans 13 deals with civil authority. And it says, obey the civil authority, because there isn't any of it unless it's of God. But at the same time, that civil authority, remember, if you go Matthew 28, Jesus said, all authority in heaven and earth has been given to me. So any authority exists. And I think this could happen with a king, because we're going to have a king one of these days. It's not going to be a democracy. He's going to rule out of Jerusalem, and he's going to say, this is the law, and you will obey it. And when that happens, prosperity and peace and tranquility and abundance will flow throughout the whole world. So you don't have to have a democracy. You don't have to have a republic. You can have different forms of government, but that government needs to be responsive to and implement the truth of God's word. And I think that's what it means. It says there's no authority but of God over there in Romans 13. However, that authority needs to represent God's truth, because you are under agreement between God and you to obey him. And when authority begins to persecute and punish you for obeying God rather than itself, then that's out of order. That's what Dr. Martin Luther King stood in. He said, I have the right to peacefully protest. That's what the apostles did. Apostles were brought in. They said, you will no longer preach in this name, the name of Jesus. And he said, well, you can say that to us, but we're under a greater command. The command was, go into all the world and preach the gospel. And Jesus said, in my name, you'll do these things. So they were under a command directly from heaven. The civil government was saying to them, you can't do it. And they said, well, we're going to respect your authority. We're going to obey you in the sense that you come and get us and take us and throw us in jail, cut our heads off, whatever you're going to do. Okay, but we are going to obey the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Because all authority, even your authority, comes from him. Remember Herod? He decided he was going to take all the authority, and he was going to tell how wonderful he was and how he'd done this and that, and he dropped dead, eaten up by worms. Look at those Roman emperors that persecuted the church. What happened to them? They went crazy. They went nuts. They committed suicide. They did all kinds of things. They hurt the church. Yes, they did. But the church flowed under the authority of the civil laws. Now, we do live in a very unique government. Who is the king of America? I thought Dr. Federer dealt with that really well at the Faith and Freedom meeting where he spoke. He said, in America, you're the king. You see, God called us to worship him. He made us free. And then in that freedom, because there are things that we can't do individually, we create a system around us to protect our land, our liberty, and our property. I said that. Land, liberty, life. So we build around that. Jefferson said in the Declaration of Independence that when any government becomes oppressive to the point it begins to take away your life, liberty, and your property, that government needs to be changed. So what do we do? Well, Romans 13 says civil authorities are God's ministers. That would be police. That would be firemen. That would be mayors and council people. That would be bosses where we work. People that are in charge in positions of authority. You get a factory where everybody's using drugs and everybody's getting drunk and everybody's down on the foreman and trying to spend as much of the day as they can in the lavatory and not do their work. That factory is doomed. That factory will not be able to produce a quality item at a low cost and will not be able to compete on the world market. You ask why did Wheaton's close over in Millville? I don't know all the ins and outs of it, but I do know this. The fancy bottles they were making for Avon was being sold in yard sales before Avon ever got them. Remember them? They had perfumes, and they made cars and all these intricate things, docks and stuff, and they had cologne in them. Yeah, they were being sold in yard sales before Avon ever got them. And Avon said, enough of that. You can't do that. You can't steal. You can't cheat. You can't lie. You cannot break the Ten Commandments and survive. An authority is there to implement God's law. And in America, our rulings, why do you have the right to declare bankruptcy in America? They never used to do that. They just throw you in jail. It's called debtor's prison. You didn't pay your bills, bingo, you're in jail till you pay it. Well, then I always wondered about it. How in the world are you ever going to pay it if you can't be work? You know what we have? You know why we have bankruptcy laws? It's because of the year of Jubilee. It's because of the seventh year freedom. All these principles that we have in this country came out of God's word as we attempted to implement them. And that's why we prospered. And we can't have a situation where people, paid people from out of state, 70% of the people that were arrested in Charlotte, North Carolina, were not from North Carolina. They were paid anarchists. And you can't have that. Smashing windows and stealing and looting. There's all kinds of violations of principles of God's word. Can't have some little kid going down the football field with a BB gun shooting out all the football field lights. Have Edna Kaufman call the mayor and tell him who it was. Can't have that. We have to respect authority because it's the Lord's authority. If I get pulled over on the side of the road for something and a policeman says, put your hands on the steering wheel. Do not get out of the car. I ain't getting out of the car. If the policeman says, stop, I'm going to stop. Teach your children to obey authority. Unless that authority is asking you to disobey God. Because that authority is there to protect you. And that spirit of lawlessness is the spirit of Antichrist. 1 John 4. And it causes people to rebel against constituted authority. And then it causes them to die and not live. Do you have to do everything? No. There are paths. You say, I respect you. I'm going to do what you say. Okay? But I think you're wrong. And every person in this country has a right to have their day in court. Do you understand how important this is? Because it is the spirit of anarchy that is trying to destroy our country. Why do we have gangs? Because we don't have proper families. How many times? And people don't want to hear that. You got Dr. Ben Carson right there. Or Carson saying, our families. We need to have our families in place. We need to have the structure right so that our children are brought up in the nurturance of the Lord. And when they're old, they won't depart from it. Why are our churches such a mess? Because we got rebellion loose in them. And there's no respect for the authority. Craziest things. Jesus said, all authority is mine. There is no authority exists except from Jesus. None. That means whatever authority I have to get one of those bracelets that says WWJD. What would Jesus do? Because I am here simply to represent him. He's the king. I'm the ambassador. Obey them that have the rule over you, for they watch for your souls as they that must give an account. The day will come when every policeman, every person, every mayor, every councilman will stand before Almighty God. His knee will bow and he will confess that he is Lord, and he will be judged on how he used his authority. Was it to get graft? Was it to make it for himself? You know, people are called public servants for a reason. They're supposed to be servants. Authority exists for you to serve. Jesus taught that when he took the towel off and he washed his disciples' feet. And he said, the world out there, it's seeking for all this power and stuff because it wants people to serve it. I've come to show you a better way. If you want to be great in my kingdom, learn to be the servant of all.